Yes. Well, it's nice seeing you out here this afternoon, this cold afternoon. And you spoke, it's a nice talk. It doesn't only apply for new participants, but I'm glad seeing some of the members here because this is, you know, this is a good talk that everybody should hear, not just for the participants. So, sorry, I thought I was already presenting. Okay. So, as our brother Mervin have mentioned, this talk is talk number 10 of your patient life program. It's growing.
Can't hear you?
Yeah. Yeah, I think you need, there's no problem with my speech, I think. I think it's,
Special request.
It's your best request of your life.
I thought you've heard enough of me, so that's why.
Can't get enough?
I don't know about that. At least you have enough. Anyway, so this talk is growing the Holy Spirit, right? This it's talk after your the ninth session, which is the Holy Spirit. The session that you had yesterday. So how was it? You know, if I may ask, how was the experience last time?
Powerful.
Any other word?
Inspired.
Any other word? From the yes.
Great.
Okay. Yeah. So for our members, I mean, what one word can you describe the? Let us see who the power of the Holy Spirit.
Humbly.
How about transformation? Right? I mean, it's transforming as well, right? I mean, that's actually the whole COP from the beginning to at least in this session, the whole COP until you're done with it. It's a transforming experience. It's not an experience. It's something that you probably can't get enough of. You know, since we've used that word, and this CFP is not the end. I mean, to some of us, I mean, to most of us, it's not the end. It's actually the beginning, right? It's actually the beginning of a new experience in your life, in your spiritual life, in your family life, and that also applies not only to you but to everyone else. You could say that being in the Spirit is always a work in progress until of course the Lord tells you, hey, you've done enough, you've done my good servant, and come to me, right? Until we take our last breath, we are in a work in progress, right? So now that you've awakened or achieved the fire within you to the session last night, right? So we'll go through a number of things that may help us continue with this process. So you could baptism in the Spirit is only the beginning, as what I've mentioned. So in order for us to grow, we need to make use of the basic principles which the Lord provides for us, which are the prayer, the study, service, and fellowship. So we will touch on these items briefly. But for the meantime, right? What is this? It's a wheel, right? So you could see our Christian life, us, to be pictured as a wheel of a car. Right? So just imagine that. So we have the outer ring, basically that's our spiritual life. That's where the rubber meets the road. You know what it is when the rubber meets the road? What do you have? You have rocks, you have rough places, we have, you know, all kinds of things that you probably wouldn't want to touch, but that's the outer ring of the fire is the one that touches the road. the hub, which is the center of the wheel, right? That's where the power comes from, right? So if the wheel turns clockwise, where is it turning first? Of course, the hub turns first clockwise. And the other way around. Or if it stops, it stops. Right? The whole tire stops. And what connects the hub to the outer rim are the spokes, right? So the power that comes from the hub, it emanates and it drives the direction of the outer rim. So our Christian life is like this, right? So this is us, the outer rim. The one in the middle, what it is Jesus, right? And then the spokes is the power that emanates from our Lord himself through the Holy Spirit, right? So the spokes here represents, at least right now we have four, no? Represents the prayer, the study, the service, and the fellowship. And for us Catholics, of course, we have the fifth spokes, which is the sacraments, right? Let's go through each one. So prayer. So the first tool is prayer. So it's a primary means of establishing and maintaining that bond between our Lord and us, right? And everybody has prayer time, right? So this is our me time with the Lord, right? It's your personal time with the Lord, right? So, but for our prayer to be effective, it must be faithful. So for us, it does not, you know, especially when we're trying to, when we started just, we started the fire in our spiritual life, like we don't have any specific, or we don't have any, I would say, faithfulness in our prayer. So for prayer to be effective, we have to be faithful. So how to be faithful? To be faithful. So to start with, we have to decide on the time. It's either the first time you open your eyes in the morning, you dedicate the time to the Lord to pray, or before you close your eyes in the evening. Or you can choose, right? It doesn't have to be those times. It could be your time in the car before getting off the work. It could be time, you know, could be time before dinner, those things like that. And your prayer has to be Holy Spirit led. What that means is that even though you have a prayer, you have a structured prayer, when you say your acts, your adoration, your completion, your thanksgiving, your supplications, those acts, when you have that. In some cases, if you keep following that routine, you know, sometimes it goes dry. You know how it is when you're following it. In most cases, you would get bored in the long term. But remember that the prayer is talking to our Lord through the Holy Spirit. So your prayer itself has to be led by the Holy Spirit. So sometimes it would be required for you to break a norm. If you feel like just crying to the Lord, just cry. You don't even have to utter a word, right? So if you have those thankfulness in our heart, all you want to do is praise Him and thank Him, right? So you don't have to follow the acts, no? And also, you don't want to be too mechanical with your prayer, right? So, in my experience, sometimes when I'm praying for the Blessed Sacrament, you know, I just stay there, not just trying to empty my mind and just sit still and then let Him talk to me. Sometimes prayer is not just us calling to Him, you know, asking for forgiveness or asking for things. Sometimes we have to sit down, really just open up ourselves, our hearts and mind, just empty it out and listen to God. Right? So another thing for prayer to be effective is that it has to be centered on our relationship with Jesus. Yeah, prayer, good prayer. You know, sometimes we have we have brothers and sisters that are really gifted with a very eloquent prayer. Right? So, and they are amazing. You know, don't get me wrong, they are amazing. they inspire, they could lead, they could guide the whole congregation in their prayer. They could make you cry, they can make you laugh with their prayer. But for us, most of us, don't be pressured by the techniques, you know, by the words. Remember, it's not about the words that comes out. You know, it's about what leads you to that moment, right? While you're conversing with God, right? So it has to be centered on our relationship with Jesus. Remember, you know, when we pray, especially when we pray as a congregation, we guide the congregation, but it is a conversation between you and Him. No? It's a conversation between you and Him. So, also to guide in our prayer, in the Catholic tradition, we have that we have the intercession of Mama Mary and all the saints as a powerful prayer. Of course, we don't forget our tradition, we don't forget our rosary, we don't forget all the prayers that was handed to us through tradition, you know, by the Catholic Church. You know? Even though they repeated it, you know, in some probably denomination, they said, you know, repetitive words doesn't mean anything. But actually, it's up to you. If you mean every word of it, it doesn't matter if it's played millions or billions of times by other people, right? If you mean every word of it, right? If you're just going through the motion, of course, then that's the problem. So that's prayer. Now, so the second tool is study. So, of course, all of us probably, one way or another, we've gone to school, right? Of course. Even as a kindergarten, you tell your kids, in order for you to get good grades, you have to study. In order for you to achieve your goal, your goal in life, you have to study. Study hard. Take high school, your bachelor's degree, go to a master's degree. You have to study. Then, but with the Lord, why not do the same? Remember, I mean, to know Him and to love Him and to serve Him more, right? So we cannot love God if we don't know Him. We cannot serve Him if we don't know Him, right? So us, it's imperative that we have to put some time into our study, right? So, three ways that we could learn about God. The Bible, right? So the Bible is the most important resource that we have or means to know God, right? His plans for us, you know, what God have done for us to get here, the way we are now, right? If you would read the Bible from cover to cover, you know, from Genesis to Revelation, you would see God's plan. I mean, you would see how amazing He is. You know, how we come to where we are right now, and how we love Him, how He plans to save us, how He plans to bring us home, right? It's all in there. All we need to do is spend some time reading the Word, reading His Word. It could be some devotion, you know, the daily devotion we have, you know, things like that. But it's all scriptural. So, for our new members, yes, you can spend 10-15 minutes, just go to the scripture, pick a verse. Have you heard of Lectio Divina? Lectio Divina, basically you pick a word, pick a verse or a paragraph in the Bible, you read it multiple times and then you reflect on it. And see what, you know, just listen to what the Lord is telling you. Just Lectio Divina. But for us, for the other members, it's been in the community for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years, even 20 years. We have really had to spend a lot of time with the scripture. Right? There's no way for us to know God if we don't read the Bible. So the next one is spiritual readings. Right? Who among us takes when you go to mass bulletins, and then you know, take it, leave it in the car, and then sometimes it just ends up directly in the recycling bin, right? This, you know, Our church is preaching that for a reason. Right? All the readings of the Mass are there. There's a lot of inspirational sharings. It's all in there. You know, we have spent a few minutes taking somebody else from there as well. Books. All the saints that have gone before us, all the apostles, right? There's a plenty of books out there, right? How can we learn from our saints if we don't read about them, right? We only know it's a fiesta because there's a lot of food. But we don't know the saint himself, we don't know, right? We don't know what he has done for the faith, right? So we have to read the spiritual readings and publications. Attendant teachings and preachings. Christian life program is one of them, right? I'm sure that you've learned a lot, right? Open our eyes, open our hearts to our faith. It's like like finding spring in the desert, right? In our diocese or even in our church, don't miss the opportunities where they offer speakers to talk, right? So try to attend those. In Couples for Christ, we have the yearly conferences. We have a team every year. So this year we have the what's our thing this year? Joyce. Praising him, thanks. Praying with thanks. So every year there's a theme, and it's always accompanied by a lot of teachings, monthly teachings related to the theme. So we take our time. We have assemblies where those are discussed as well. We have general assemblies where we invite priests to speak to us in special topics. So we have to take time and make sure that we attend those. Those are not merely there because we are required, is a checklist for us. No, it's not. I mean, our leaders and the church are putting those as part of our growth, for us to grow. So the next one is service. So service is now that we have the Holy Spirit in us, so it's not just service; it's not just for our personal development, but also to equip us in effective service for Him, our God, and His people. When we ask for service, it's not merely asking you to do something, right? It's basically offering ourselves to God. For His plans and for His work. That's what service is. For us, as CFC members or even faithful, we have to take on the heart of a servant. Right? We have to be... service is actually a humbling experience. Because when you serve, even in the community or even in the church, there's no status, there's no position. I mean, it doesn't matter if you're have a master's degree, it doesn't matter if you're a high school graduate, it doesn't matter what your position is, it doesn't matter. Because what matters is that you're doing what you're doing your best, you're giving your best in service for the Lord. So service helps us to grow because it touches the most basic attitudes that we have of ourselves and our independence. As I've said, to serve others is to be humble. So there are many ways to serve. Yes, go to this one. Right? There are so many ways to serve. So we can serve God with the way we live our lives. Right? Just trying to be holy. We can also serve by performing our basic responsibilities. You're a dad, you're a mom, you're a brother, you're a sister. Right? Those are our basic responsibility. And we can serve others by just And we can serve others by recognizing that the many built-in opportunities and service day-to-day life. The key point here is that when we serve, right? When we serve, it's not just us physically giving ourselves, but we serve as a witness of our faith in Jesus by the way we live, or by the way we live our lives. So we're not there just to have a check mark or a checklist or a bucket list. Oh, I got this list. No, it's not. You're there to serve as a witness for others, so they could also glorify God. Right? So we don't serve to be recognized. Right? We don't serve to be recognized. So if somebody asks you, Brother Eddie, hey, brother, can you take out the trash after the assembly if you don't mind? Me, take out trash? Come on, I'm a supervisor. I don't take out trash. No. For us, as faithful, we serve, in any which way we can, right? There's no low kind of work or I just want to be able to manage. No, that's not. You're gonna serve whatever you are called, right? Whatever you're called for. Sometimes, when it's inconvenient for us, right? So be alert to opportunities to share your faith verbally with family, friends, neighbors, coworkers, and the world at large. And make ourselves a resource available for God's work, our time, our talent, and treasure. Those are the three P's. So, I know in our case, in reality, right? All of us are busy, right? A lot of us maybe doesn't have any talent. Everybody has talent. Come on. And treasure. This is probably the most things because that we hold on to. This is probably the last one that, right? We are called to give all. Not just one, not just two, but we have to give all. Right? So the fourth is fellowship. So what is fellowship? It's basically everything that the first two, that the Christians do together. Not only the parties, come on. Fellowship is everything that we do together. What we do now, this is a fellowship. What we do as a body of Christ is a fellowship. So we do not become a Christian by ourselves. That's probably one of the main reasons that you guys are here. Right? We all realize that we cannot be a Christian by ourselves. It's tough, right? It's tough. Imagine a thread, just one thread. Just pull it easily. You could pull it. Put a whole bunch of them together and try to break them. Right? It's tough. So we are stronger when we are together. So Christianity is not a one man game. It's not a one man sport. You have to be with your wife, husband and wife. Your family, and then with the larger community. So, we do not become complete Christians by ourselves. We must be joined to others in order to experience the fullness of Christian life. We need the support of others. We need their wisdom and strength, especially those elders in the community. We need their wisdom and strength. And we need to do things together. Fellowship is not an optional extra. So after the Christian Life program, right? I think in the next talk, household or prayer group would be discussed, would be explained to you. That's part of the fellowship, right? Praying as a group. So in that, you would experience the fullness of Christ. That's why I'm saying fellowship is not an optional extra. So household meeting is not an optional thing that we do in the community. It's a must, right? It is a must. So some ways to experience Christian fellowship. worship and liturgies, we go to mass together, prayer meetings, conference, as I have mentioned, coming together for teachings and formation, we have that as well in the community, and serving together. Just to mention, in the CFC, just recently, we went to the food bank in New Jersey, and all the kids were there. They were in three big boxes, putting in those pasas in the Ziploc. They were having a great time, right? So that, you know, just showing that, you know, the service, you know, you can do it by yourself, you can volunteer too, but it's more fun when you're doing it with the family, it's more fun when you're doing it with the community. Social gatherings, of course. That's the reason why it's the last one. So, in some cases, you know, we probably have to remind our brothers and sisters that we don't put the social gatherings on the first. Right. Let's skip that one. That's not next week, that's today. So the last one is the sacrament. Sacrament, receiving the sacrament is probably the most important tool that we have in growing in the Holy Spirit. In the Catholic tradition, the most important tools of the Spirit book are the sacraments, right? So this is, and most importantly, the receiving of the sacrament of reconciliation and the sacrament of the Holy Communion, right? So I'm not going to ask you guys what are the seven sacraments, right? I think you know them by heart, right? Right? Okay. So the purpose of the sacraments is to make people holy, to build up the body of Christ, and to give worship to God. The sacrament imparts sanctifying grace. So for all of us as Catholic, you know, we are recommended to go to the sacrament of reconciliation at least once a year. But of course, it's a good practice also for our kids to accept that the sacrament more often than once a year. So to conclude, brothers and sisters, so this Christian Life program is your commitment to Christ. The baptism in the Holy Spirit, all of these are just the beginning of your new life. The tools that I've mentioned, I'm not sure if any of you are after the, has a retirement account or 401k, right? I mean, have you heard of the word dollar cost averaging, right? Dollar cost averaging is basically you put in money, a part of your savings every month into your 401k. Regardless whether the market is good or bad, you buy those securities or stocks at the rates where you're putting in your money, right? In the same way, when we put our these tools into practice, you don't wait to have a sunny day. You don't wait to have a rainy day. You don't wait market is up. You don't wait. Basically, you have to do it in our convenient, and then most especially in our most inconvenient time, right? There's no excuse for us to say, "Yo, here's my calendar. Look for a schedule where I could actually attend for a teaching." In some cases, the teachings are actually scheduled 6 months, even a year in advance, right? So for us, even the community, we have to plan around those things. We don't plan those teachings around our own personal schedules, right? So, being in a community, even us, right? At this stage in our life, I mean, it's basically you've enlisted in the army of God. All of us, we have enlisted in the army of God. We have to go through training. That's why I'm saying we are all a work in progress. We have to go through. For us to be in a battle, we have to know. We have to train. We have to be physically fit. We have to know our tools, our weapons. We have to know those. For somebody who wants to run a full marathon or even half marathon, You don't decide one day, oh, there's a marathon next week, I'm going to sign up. When you even haven't even run a mile on the street or even on the treadmill, right? So for us, we are training to run a full marathon for God, right? So to train for that marathon, we have to avail of all these tools. We have to train ourselves little by little, you know, no pressure. But we have to start somewhere. 5-10 minutes of prayer, Bible time, right? Try to attend our household meetings, you know, faithfully, consistently, right? Try attending the Mass, no excuses. You know, Mass, you have at least 4 or 5 for the parishes that you're attending, no excuse. You pick your time, right? So, for us as faithful, in order for us to grow, really grow in the Spirit, we have to take those seriously. So, if you are faithful, my brother and sister, you will grow in the Holy Spirit and be more blessed and be a blessing to your family, to your friends, to anyone, to any person that you encounter. So, with that, my brothers and sisters, you got the praise. Thank you very much.
Dino, and that was a very educational and inspiring talk, right? Like, it's not like after what you've experienced, we've all experienced from last night in the receiving the power of the Holy Spirit, we've got all these tools that we can use in order to grow in the Spirit. And if we continue, like I said, apply this or practice all of this, then, you know, we will enhance and even really effectively use all the gifts that we receive. Now, before we proceed to our next session, I guess I'll let everyone, especially the participants, if you want to take any break, a bathroom break or refreshments at the back for now, just to then I guess 5 minutes would be enough, and then we'll come back and then proceed to our next talk. So that we can speed things up. I know we don't want to hold you too late for today. Hopefully we'll finish as early as we could. And so in 5 minutes, we'll start our next session.
Kasi So, lumipat na sila, nasa short hills na sila, pero sabi niya, actually, we're looking for a community, walang FFLs sa loob naman. So, kaya, ano sila,
live out our faith, right? Because faith without works basically is dead, as we always read or know from taking from the Bible. It's hard, right? It's hard to manifest our faith, use our gifts from the Holy Spirit if we are not putting that into action and living it out in in a community or in the church. So the next speaker that we have to give us that talk, which is about the life and mission of Couples for Christ, is a brother that I've always looked up to, because he's so, even though he lives from afar, it doesn't matter. He goes to missions, he goes to other services, no matter where it takes him to serve, you know, in the church and in the community. This brother of ours has been married to Sister Nancy for 31 years now, and still going strong. And they had their CLP back in 1997, so 19 years. So that's good. And they have four kids. One girl who's 28 years old now, three boys ages 26, 25, 14. Wow, just like me, I have four kids, but so far I can only bring the two little ones, because the two teenagers have their own thing with their mom right now. But hopefully my wife, actually, it's one thing too that I always forget, I'm not sure if I have introduced to you my wife yet. She's supposed to make it today because she's just, again, busy with the kids, but I heard they're coming back home, so most likely she'll follow in this place, here. And now, again, talking about our dear brother here, he served in many capacities. He was a former area head here in the community in Couples for Christ in New Jersey. He's a member of what we call the governance team of CFC. And he's, as I said, he's a mission coordinator, right? Goes to different places, gives CLPs and talks wherever, where it's needed. And currently he's a member of what we call a fraternal household. It's for our brothers that help us and guide the community in its service and direction. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce to you our dear brother, Roel Moldez.
Thank you, Brother Marvin. Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. You know, it's with joy and gladness to be back here in the South Chapter. And, I was so deep in my heart, I was so glad that, slowly the chapter is growing, it's growing bigger. I've seen a lot of new faces, and it's just a manifestation that indeed each and every one of us allow ourselves to be God's instrument, to touch other people's life. So, brothers and sisters, you have heard the talk about the basic tools of how we'll be able to grow our Christian life, as the tools also that we need to grow us in faith with our Lord Jesus Christ. And I just imagine that this is the second to the last talk of Module 3, and just one more talk, you will be invited to be dedicated as member of Couples for Christ. And praise God to that, brothers and sisters. And, as we go into this talk number 11, you have, as I understand, you were able to undergo the receiving the power of the Holy Spirit last night. So it's quite, the schedule is quite hectic, yesterday and then today. But again, we are now in talk number 11, and probably at the back of your mind you try to ask, we're here for a couple of talks already, this Christian Life program. And you might be asking, what is this Couples for Christ is all about? And this is very important, brothers and sisters, because today you might be joining this very charismatic community of Couples for Christ. So that's why it's also our obligation as your brothers and sisters to inform you the life and mission of Couples for Christ. So Again, you might be asking, what is Corpus for Christ? I'll just briefly go to the brief history of Corpus for Christ. Corpus for Christ, or CFC in short, is a Christian family renewal community. And it started in June 1981 in Manila, Philippines. So that's practically 35 years, right? 35 years of existence. With just 16 couples. And since then, with leaps and bounds, it grows rapidly that we are now in more than 100 countries all over the world. And probably we're over a million members all over the world. And conquering countries, cultures, races, you know. And if we think about it, brothers and sisters, 16 couples from Manila, Philippines, which is too far away. And then we are now, after 35 years, more than 100 countries all over the world. Do you think this is a work of man? No. I would say this is the work of God through the Holy Spirit, which you have the opportunity to receive last night, which He instituted to the hearts and minds of ordinary people like us, to the 16 couples. And then, because of that grace of the Holy Spirit to the 16 couples, dedicating themselves, you know, offering their time, their talent, treasures, for the greater glory of God, they were able to, you know, to spread out the good news to other people. And not only in the Philippines, but all over the over 100 countries all over the world. So just like the early Christians, where they were able to receive the power of the Holy Spirit from fearful Christians, they were able to conquer the Roman Empire, and they were able to convert 3,000 to Christianity. And it can be likened to these couples for Christ. So the reason why I give you this this brief background, brothers and sisters, is that we are not, this is just a manifestation that what we are here, we are not depending on our own human abilities. These brothers and sisters here rely too much on God's grace through the Holy Spirit. Nobody's paid here. We spent time, talent, and treasure to share the good news to other people. Because if the Holy Spirit is in us, aside from the individual transformation, that is what we call the inward dimension that's happening in us, there is an urge or a desire to share this new transformation in us. We want to share this to other people, the joy that we experience being reunited once again with our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So, that's why, well, you are now the participants, but I'm quite sure, because of the power of the Holy Spirit, the next time around that we will have a CLP here in South Jersey, you will be bringing with you guests or invited participants for the Christian Life Program, because you want to share the joy that you experience with the Holy Spirit in you. Amen? Amen. Praise God. So with that, brothers and sisters, let's try to ask, what are we called to do? Corpus for Christ. So, I'd just like to read to you, just like any organization, we also have vision and mission. So, I'd like to read to you the vision of Couples for Christ. So, the vision of Couples for Christ is families in the Holy Spirit, renewing the face of the earth. Okay? Families in the Holy Spirit, renewing the face of the earth. And I'll try to expound that because we have expanded vision on that. It says here, moved by the Holy Spirit, one with the Catholic Church, blessed to witness to Christ's love and service, Couples for Christ is a united global community of family evangelizers that sets the world on fire with the fullness of God's transforming love. So again, remember that. In a way, you will have that vision given to you, a copy of that as part of your kit. Again, families in the Holy Spirit renewing the face of the earth. Now, CFC's mission is building the church of the home, building the church of the poor. So, the expanded version is, we are couples for Christ. We are committed to live in God's righteousness and holiness, evangelizing people through a life of love and service. We shall work for the renewal of families that will serve God and build generations of Christian leaders. And we shall pursue total Christian liberation through social justice, respect for life, and work with the poor. Couples for Christ has also a statement of philosophy, brothers and sisters, which we really aspire in our Christian life. So I'll read that to you briefly. Couples for Christ adheres to a set of beliefs and ideals from which flow its Christian values, attitudes, and behavior, as well as its teachings, programs, and approaches to Christian renewal within the context of family relationships. Couples for Christ, we believe in marriage as an indissoluble institution, as taught by our Lord Jesus Christ, and that God created marriage primarily for the love between man and woman, and for the procreation and proper rearing of children. We believe that God created man and wife with equal personal worth and dignity, and that God ordained order in the family by giving the man the role as head of the family and the woman as his helpmate and support, which roles best express their complementarity. We believe in the inalienable and irreplaceable right and responsibility of parents to educate their children, and that children need to be educated in essential human and Christian values for them to become responsible and mature members of society. We believe that the family, in practicing the gospel message, shares in the life and mission of the church through prayers, evangelization, and service to others, especially to the poor. We believe that Christian family renewal can be best be achieved by inviting Jesus to be the Lord of our homes, by allowing the power of the Holy Spirit to lead our family lives, and through the full use of all spiritual gifts at our disposal. And lastly, we believe in the material mediation and intercession of our Blessed Mother Mary in bringing us all closer to her Son Jesus. Devotion to Mary leads us, devotion to Jesus that will lead to our sanctification. So, that is our vision, mission, and statement of philosophy. So, from these brothers and sisters, we can see the importance of the mission of Couples for Christ today. that the family as the basic unit in society is really part of God's plan. So the very center of God's plan for humanity, brothers and sisters, comes through the family. And that is made possible by the union of man and woman through the sacrament of marriage, so that we can, you know, grow in numbers who will eventually praise and glorify Him. So, but if you take a look, you know, in this modern world, there are so many forces in the world today that seek to destroy the family, especially the evil one. So, from this, it's not, you know, it's not by accident that God really instituted couples for Christ, because our existence, we are here, we are raised by God to primarily defend His work. To primarily defend His work. Our task here is to strengthen family life, to protect our marriage, to rear our children in a Christian way. And that is primarily our reason for being here in this community. So, how do we accomplish our mission? First, by working for the renewal of individuals, families, and the church on a global basis. So, that's why we are conducting always Christian life program. By providing strong support environment for our members. If you're already a member of Couples for Christ, we would like we support one another. So the next question is, if we are a member, how do we support one another here in Couples for Christ? So first, we support one another through our committed relationships. We believe that we have a responsibility as members of Couples for Christ to encourage and support one another in the Christian life. We journey together in our faith and our Christian life. So, thus we make commitment to grow together as Christian couples. We share, you know, our experiences. We share our difficulties, our challenges. Because that's the essence of a community. We share one another through thick and thin. So we have a 5-point commitment, which is embodied in a small white card, which is what we call a covenant card, which will be explained to you in the next talk. And there, briefly explain to you what is our covenant with God when we join couples with Christ. So, the second one, again, the first one is through our committed relationships. So the second one that we support one another here in Couples for Christ is through households. All members of Couples for Christ belong to what we call cell groups, or we call it households. At the end of the Christian Life program, if you make a commitment to be a member of Couples for Christ, you will be assigned to a household. The purpose of this household is to have a smaller and more intimate environment for personal support in the Christian life, and to provide a means for encouraging growth as a Christian. So, in the household, we can share life experiences and God's practical wisdom, and then we can help one another to overcome obstacles in our Christian life. So, a household is composed normally of 4 to 7 couples. 4 to 7 couples. And is headed by what we call the leader couple. And this is immediately set up after the Christian Life program. So after your third indication, probably the chapter head, Brother Fernando, will assign you to a particular household. So the household meets once a week, ideally once a week. And based on the mutually agreed day among the members, among the members as well as the couple leader, you will agree among yourselves what particular day of the week that you will meet regularly. Then, the household meetings are held in the homes of the group members on a rotation basis. So, you might be asking, why do we do it in the household? Why not? I mean, in the home, so why not here? So, worshiping the Lord in our home makes us, you know, makes the truth that indeed our home is a domestic church. And likewise, it gives us the opportunity to, you know, to share and to show with our family members, even extended families, that our faith and our Christian way are the manifestation of our faith. So the third one is by our going, teaching, and formation. So first, again, I'll repeat. We support one another here in CFC by our committed relationships. Second is through households. The third one is by our ongoing teaching and formation. So after you dedicate yourselves, there is what we call a first year formation or teaching program. So after your dedication, you will have, during the household, you will review the talks that we had here in CLP. And after the review, you will undergo what we call covenant orientation. We'll try to expound further all those things that that you will find in the covenant card. And then, likewise, we have what we call marriage enrichment retreat. This is, you know, to enhance further our relationship as couple, as husband and wife. Then we have evangelization training. This is to, you know, to prepare us when we will have another round of Christian Life program, wherein the new members will have opportunity to know how to evangelize other people. So beyond the first year, there are so many other courses or training or formation tracks that we have. We also have various teachings, and then prayer meetings and other occasions. And then the last one, by other regular activities of our community, which we normally do, just like monthly prayer meeting or assemblies, and this is done by chapter. By the way, New Jersey has three chapters. We have the North, the Central, and the South chapter. We are here in the South chapter. So every month, we will have assemblies by chapter. So we will meet as one big group here in South chapter, and then we have worship, we have sharings, we have probably special teachings, depending on what the chapter head will give us. And then we also have Lord's Day celebrations. We also observe anniversaries. Here in New Jersey, we just have our anniversary celebration last November 12, right? Yeah. November 12. We held it down in North area. And this is the time where all the members of Couples for Christ in New Jersey meet. And then we have family days. We have evangelization rallies, and we also have conferences. Here in the US, we have what we call East Coast Conference, and we have East Coast Hip Conference, and we have West Coast Conference. So, and this happens every year. And next year, the conference next year for East Coast, where we belong, we will have a joint conference with Canada, the East, East part of Canada, and it will be held in Toronto next year. So if you have the chance, let's go together in Toronto, and we're able to experience God's love and mercy and healing, especially during the conferences. So, in conclusion, brothers and sisters, you have heard some basic information and what we do here in Couples for Christ. So, we are living in exciting times. We have experienced a lot of challenges, but God is a loving Father and merciful Father that He blessed us to have this community that will aid us in our journey of our Christian faith and Christian life. I think all of us agree, brothers and sisters, that we are all just pilgrims in this world, right? Whether we like it or not, we will depart from this world. Well, most of us, always plan for our retirement, for our future, investing in a 401k, savings account, investments. But the true preparation, brothers and sisters, is the next life. Let us always be mindful of that. We cannot bring along all our wealth, but it's a new life to come. And that is the part that we should invest while we are here in this world. And that is precisely what we're doing right now. Because again, the transformation that we gain to the grace of God, to His Holy Spirit, there is an urge now to share it with others, because we feel the joy, the transformation that happens in us. There's a lot of stories, brothers and sisters, that sometimes those who are now in Couples for Christ are in one way or another, they're in their married life will almost break up, but they were able to bind together more their relationship because they joined Couples for Christ and they attended the Christian life. And I'm also one of those brothers and sisters. My wife almost left me because I have a colorful life before. But again, God is so merciful, God is so good that He gave me a chance. And when we joined Couples for Christ in 1997, we have 13 talks back home in the Philippines. And with God's grace, we're able to sustain without any absence with these 13 talks. And after that, I dedicate myself and ourselves with my wife to this work of God through the Couples for Christ. And I'm quite sure, brothers and sisters, you will allow yourself to be God's instrument to bring back the honor and glory to Him. Thank you, and may God bless you.